I think there's a solid chance Mason Marchman's gonna check under his bed for Jake McCabe tonight. Well, if you saw the look on McCabe's face, I think there's a solid chance he'll find him.
Let's go!
Good. We all feel good.
Stop!
Never gets rusty!
What am I doing?
Get in my kitchen! Producer Drew, can you fix all this?
And when it comes to the Toronto Maple Leafs, you can crumple, crumple, yeet!
Saw that going differently.
With you wherever you are, welcome to LFR.
Victory, Puppy Ziggy! I don't know why I've never tried to do this before. Here we go, here we go. Whoop! You didn't even know where it was! He was looking at the wrong part of the stick.
I don't know why, but I think this is actually signed by Luke Shen.
We get him back, by the way, that'd be great. 2 points! We like 2 points! Leafs win! 5-4 over the Dallas Stars! Was it a Mona Lisa? No, but that doesn't mean you can't hang it on the fridge and be proud of it! So look, the other day the Leafs played a game against the New York Islanders, and it was actually a pretty good game that got completely erased because they lost in the final 2 minutes to Pierre Engvall! Well, what are the positives you take away from this game? Well, this and this and this, and then it's like a magnadoodle shake-a-shake-a gone! So it's difficult to remember the good things that the Leafs did in that game, and it's difficult to look at the Leafs in this game against the Dallas Stars and go, the Leafs should be the favorites. The Leafs should win this one. Here's the thing, they should! Scott Wedgwood is in net for the Dallas Stars, and yes, he has a record of 13-4-4, which is bananas for a backup. He's the backup. The other guy, Jake Oettinger, was an all-star. I'd rather play the backup. Well, why weren't the Leafs playing the all-star? Why'd they make him the backup? Because they played last night in Buffalo. So the Dallas Stars are on the road. They're the tired team giving you the backup goalie. And the Leafs are healthy, relatively. Relatively speaking, they're missing some players, but the core's there. You should win this game. But there were two things working against the Leafs. Number one, as if to drive home the point that this general area is the lifeblood of hockey, the Dallas Stars uploaded a video before this game basically just highlighting all the Toronto-ish born players who always play every game against the Leafs like it's game 7 of the Stanley Cup final, which is where you take the opportunity for the easy joke that I set you up for. Steve, if they were playing like it was game 7 of the Stanley Cup final, they would not be there. The other thing is, despite the fact that the Leafs should win this game, they often lose games like that. So what did this game end up being? It was the game of a billion penalties. Actually, now that I look at it, it was only 8. It's just that they all ended up as goals. There were 9 goals in this game, and 5 of them were either on a power play or a penalty shot. First one, the Leafs get a power play off a penalty drawn by Nick Robertson. Dude, if Nick Robertson played every game like it was against the Dallas Stars, he'd be making $7 million a year. On that power play, Morgan Riley over to William Nylander, who cracks that thing like it made fun of his Rogers commercial. Nylander's 24th of the season, I think he's back, and the Leafs are up 1-0. Unfortunately, that was just about the last good thing to report on in that first period. Nylander's goal was less than 7 minutes into the game, and if I'm not mistaken, it was on the Leafs' second shot. Now, first of all, you should already have more than 2 shots by that point, but you have the lead, so what am I gonna do? What am I gonna do? That means for the final 13 and a half some odd minutes of the first period, the Leafs only got 2 shots, which is worse. Jake McCabe takes a high stick on Mason Marchment. Hold that thought. The Dallas Stars go to the power play. On that power play, a lot of people don't know this, but when Jamie Benn is not trying to cross-check you in the ribs so hard that you could read J. Benn on your pancreas, he can actually score some goals. You give me a diagram of the human body, I have no idea where the pancreas is. Did I do good? People who went to school for this sort of thing, did I do good? Liver? Kidneys? Kidneys. Kidney sounds right. Anyway, he scored, and it's a tie game. And Jake McCabe's tough first period continued because he and Mark Giordano had to do a little switcheroo after an offensive zone turnover. I believe it was Ryan Reeves on that one. Evgeny Dodonov is coming in, and McCabe has a great deal of distance between him and Dodonov because he's playing it like, you know what? I think this guy's gonna swoop across the middle. And then Dodonov did, and McCabe still did nothing. Dodonov tucks it 5-hole, and it's a 2-1 Dallas Stars lead. Would you like a save there? Would you like a save there? Yeah, you probably like a save there, but that is some brutal defense. So that's late in the first period. The Dallas Stars take the lead, and like I just said, you don't love that goal from Samsonov, but something really important for the story of this game happened. He tightened up. His overall stats for the game will not be smiled upon. This is maybe his worst game since sort of picking it back up. His movements were kind of big, like he didn't even look all that great. But especially throughout the second period, this guy was bailing the Leafs out and making some really important saves. Early in the second period, John Tavares did one of my favorite things. He draws a penalty, a hooking penalty, on Tyler Seguin, just a couple top 2 picks going at it. You know what's weird? I'm gonna say something weird. John Tavares was only picked a year ahead of Tyler Seguin.
Right?
Like, that doesn't feel... One feels a lot more dad and the other feels a lot more daddy. You know what I mean? You can look at me where I'm not wrong on this.
Anyway, on the power play, Tavares wins the faceoff after drawing the call. Gives it to Willie, who holds on to it, just teases the puck a little bit. Patience, gets it to Tavares, who also cranks the thing. His 15th of the season and second in as many games, he's done with his little slump too. Ties the game at twos.
I know that Willie and Tavares did it on the power play, but it doesn't feel like a coincidence that both of them seem to bust their slump at the same time. Wingers need their centers and centers need their wingers. And Bertuzzi basically doesn't play with a stick. So like those two have to get each other out of it.
After that, the Leafs kill off one of the very few penalties in this game that were actually killed off for too many men on the ice. No, 10 on the season. I don't care if they've been good boys for a little while. No!
Thank goodness that they didn't have to pay for that one, because then Pontus Holmberg, who is growing on me in a big way, draws a call off of Miro Heiskanen. Like, go off, kid. As I said, go off, kid, I had to check. Holmberg is actually older than Heiskanen. They're both 24. It's just he's older by months. Anyway, that's one of the premier defensemen in the NHL, and Holmberg, again, kind of one-handed, draws the call. He's gonna do that more and more often, and the way that you do that is by doing the right things, and he just kind of does them. Frustrating at times. Yes, frustrating. But as guys are trying to hold onto their jobs, as the team is in trade rumors, and we will talk about that, Holmberg should probably hold on to his job. Leafs go to the power play, and the most hilarious goal of the season gets scored. Auston Matthews goes to pass it, and it goes off a leg and in. Even his passes are goals! His 41st of the season, because thank goodness someone keeps track, I would have lost count if they hadn't! And the Leafs take the 3-2 lead. We like that. Now, end of the second period, and the penalties are still important to the story. A bit of a change in the pace. Holmberg, this time, is on the wrong end of a penalty. He gets called for holding on Matt Duchene. Now, is it a hold? It's a regular season hold, maybe. But when we think about embellishing in the NHL, we think about someone like diving. We think about someone grabbing their face when they didn't actually get high-sticked or falling down when they didn't need to fall down. We don't think of embellishing as an attacking player grabbing the hand of a defending player, but to me, that's what happened here. Duchene sold it, and good for him. He beat the ref on that one. And you look, and you go, all right, the Leafs have the lead, and all three goals are power play goals. Maybe we shouldn't complain. And the Leafs kill it off, we definitely shouldn't complain. And then at the end of the second period, Mason Marchmont just tries to kill Jake McCabe. And McCabe, his visor obviously went down onto his nose. He's cut, he's bleeding all over the place, screaming bloody murder. Now, did Jake McCabe have a good first period? No, he did not have a good first period at all. And the vast majority of Leaf fans will not remember that in the morning. They will remember the horrifying face of Jake McCabe smashing a stick and screaming at people while bleeding from the face in a photo that I can't show you because I don't want to get demonetized. And honestly, the Leafs are lucky they won this hockey game, because during the third period, Jake McCabe sort of stopped playing hockey and started playing attempted crimes. And for the first half of the third period, that sort of worked. And then the Leafs get caught, and it's Evgeny Dodonov in a foot race with the oldest active player in the National Hockey League. Oldest active player in the National Hockey League gets called for the penalty shot. Here it is. And Dodonov, who was 2 for 3 in penalty shots in his career before that, makes it 3 for 4. In Samsonov's defense, he had about as much help on that goal as he had on the first Dodonov goal, and there was no one on the ice for this one. So it's tied again for 32 seconds because Mitch Marner, he's found a goal-scoring touch. You forget the goal. Forget the goal. I'm not going to show you the goal. I'm going to show you this. This. Look at this picture. Look at this picture. Zoom in on Mitch's face. Look at this. Look at this right here. Tell me that is not the face of a man with infinite swagger right now. Dude, we've been talking about Marner all season. There's been a weird vibe. Something's been a little strange there, especially at the beginning, but I tell you what, lately? This is one of the best players in the league lately, I'm telling you. In fact, this goal put him 2 behind William Nylander in terms of goal scoring for only a few seconds until Tavares to Willie, and he scores again! Nylander is 2nd of the game and 25th of the season! The Leafs have a 2-goal lead all of a sudden. The Dallas Stars tied the game 11:05 into the third period. And the Leafs had gained a 2-goal lead before it reached 12 minutes into the third period. Now, all you gotta do is shut it down. Well, you know, easier said than done. With the goaltender pulled, Wyatt Johnston, one of the more underrated players out there, I feel like if you know about him, you're a bit of a geek. Like, not geek derogatory, geek compliment. You ever get a word stuck? Compliment. Complimentary. Geek complimentary. There it is. Really good rookie season with the Dallas Stars, and he's following it up by continuing to be good, and now the Stars are within one. Also, that goal was scored with the goalie pulled, which means that six of the goals scored in this game were either power play, penalty shot, or with an extra player. I know it's technically even strength, but is it? So, bit of a clencher. We don't feel very good about that, but the Leafs end up winning anyway. Sad that it wasn't a two-goal lead. I don't care. Sad that William Nylander didn't get the hat trick for my fantasy team, but they won because they gosh darn should've. I don't have any notes. That's not true. I have lots of notes. That's why this video is so long. Sorry, Drew. I'm sorry. Like I said at the beginning of this video, was it a Mona Lisa? No, but you're still hanging on the fridge. Ilya Samsonov did not have the greatest game, but he still gave his team a chance to win. Even in the first period, when I didn't think the team was playing very well, Nylander looked incredible. That was like his pre-contract signing effort. It had nothing to do with the points. Tavares looks fully invigorated. I really liked Matthew Nye's game. Liked Marner's game. Obviously liked Matthew's game. I'm glad Morgan Rielly stayed in the game after taking a bit of a bad bump. They got some pretty good shifts out of the fourth line. Like, that's a good game. That is a good game. And it was shown on the scoreboard. Questions. I like this from Insider J Money. Reeves Masterclass, and it shows a chart. I think this is from Money Puck. Reeves was on the ice for about 75% of the Leafs' expected goals. He was one of the best players on the ice in that regard for both teams. Honestly, over the last few games that he's actually played, he's looked like the Ryan Reeves that was advertised at the beginning of the season. I know he had a not very good play in this game that led to a goal against, but like, he was just sort of, you couldn't even say he was doing cardio for a while, because in order to do cardio, you need to like go fast, and he wasn't doing that. Now he is a factor. He is a positive factor. He's usually on the ice for like a scoring chance four, at least once a game these days. He's not just hitting, but like also being a jerk. And it helps that his line isn't getting hemmed in. Ryan Reeves got into the lineup because they had to put him in the lineup. Right now, he's playing like a guy who's in the lineup because he should be in the lineup. This is a bit of a two-parter. With these big rumors coming out today about a trade, what do you think the Leafs get in a trade, and who are they giving up? So the first tweet is from an account that I think a lot of you know about, called Incarcerated Bob. He said, Leafs are up to something with a Western Conference team last 24 hours. Buzz coming from Canada. Hashtag NHL trade deadline. Now, Incarcerated Bob definitely sounds like just a random person on Twitter, and perhaps they are. I don't know their real identity, but this account, over the years, like years and years, has broken deals in hockey, and I want to say like other sports too. And then the second part from Nick Alberga, who also has some good information from time to time, an intermission tidbit, hearing Leafs and Flames, who do play in the Western Conference, continue to talk trade. Sounds like Toronto could be looking to acquire a D and forward package, speculate away. Here's why I'm nervous about saying the Leafs are gonna for sure make a trade with the Flames. I had someone tweet me like, oh, what about Nazem Kadri? That would be wild for the vibes. I'm weary of saying the Flames for sure. One, because the Calgary Flames are consistently difficult when it comes to these sorts of conversations. But also, Brad Treliving, like, he's not quiet out there. Like, everyone I speak to has heard some sort of trade rumor. You know from the podcast this week that I heard whispers about Tony DeAngelo in the Leafs, and I said several rosaries praying no for that not to happen. But I guess what I'm saying is the Leafs are rumored to be in on everybody, especially defenders. Ideally, defenders who shoot right. I had some people tweeting me about Noah Hanifin. He does not. Chris Tanev does. The one thing I'll say about the Flames, I've been making fun of them on the podcast for like being in every trade rumor, like even more than the Leafs, and then doing nothing. And then the Flames have promptly done lots of things. Obviously, the Elias Lindholm deal was huge for them. And also, they signed Pospisil to a multi-year deal today. And the reason I bring up Pospisil as well is because they're getting stuff done. And usually in the NHL, when you're getting stuff done early in February, it's so you could get stuff done a little later in February. And the Flames just took Braden Paakkal off of waivers from the Vegas Golden Knights. I forgot about that one. Like, the Flames all of a sudden are, like, noisy. They're pretty noisy. As for what a defense forward package could look like coming from Calgary, I really have no idea. Looking at the team, like, Mangiapane has got a year after this one at 5.8. Maybe. Andre Kuzmenko has got a year left after this at 5.5. Maybe. I think a smart one for the Flames would be to sell high on Sharon Govich, who only makes 3.1 this year and next. The Leafs would be wise to inquire. The Flames would be wise to charge an arm and a leg, though. The only other guy I could see at all, like, the Leafs are rumored to be in on a center, and Kevin Rooney is a center with an expiring $1.3 million deal. I could see Timothy Liljegren and or Connor Timmins going the other way in a deal. I worry about a move that's a pure buy for the Leafs just because they really don't have a ton of prospects. They really don't have a ton of picks. It makes me nervous. But I do want them to do something, so you gotta take the good with the bad. So, that is it for this one. Thank you very much for watching. Click like if you like this video. Click subscribe if you really liked it. Tell all your friends. Brand new Steve Dangle podcast was uploaded today. There's going to be another one Friday. And I don't even know if I'm supposed to tell you this. I'm going to tell you this anyway. We should have some Steve Dangle podcast news soon. I've said too much.